Jefferson Davis, Ouachita, Vermilion, Vernon, Rapides, Natchitoches, Sabine, Wynn, Grant, Jackson, and Lincoln. So far, more than 80,000 individuals have registered. FEMA has distributed thus far $8.1 million in assistance. So I just can't stress enough how important it is for people to register with FEMA for assistance. Go ahead and start that process. There may be an additional denial because you don't provide some necessary piece of information, but work through that, get that information in as soon as you can, so don't give up. It also remains very important to listen to your local officials regarding all sorts of things, the availability of services, commodities, you name it, various types of assistance, but also as it relates to reentry. Because remember, we're trying to restore basic services. We have power crews, we have first responders in there. There's still a lot of debris down, and so the reentry plan will be announced locally by the Offices of Emergency Preparedness in the various parishes that are affected. So please listen to your local officials concerning reentry. We obviously still have a number of water systems that are completely out. I think the community water systems that are out are more than 30 across the state of Louisiana, concentrated primarily in that southwestern portion of our state. Widespread power outages remain a concern. The mobility of utility crews that are trying to work, again, first responders, debris removal, there's a lot going on. And there are strained resources as well. But when you get back into your community, you may find that there's no operating grocery store, gas station, pharmacy, those sorts of things. So it's really important that you heed the guidance that you're given from local officials about reentry. I will tell you that I've had a number of conversations with parish officials from the affected communities, and they are working extremely hard in partnership with us and our federal partners as well. And there's been an awful lot of progress made in terms of the resources that are being brought to bear to aid in this response and in recovery. There's still a very, very long way to go, however. But I did want to just thank everyone for all the hard work that's happening, and not just in the public sector, but we've seen faith-based organizations, nonprofits. We've seen just private individuals being very generous in terms of donations, in terms of setting up food distribution sites and serving hot meals. And we've actually seen some private citizens putting together distribution sites that rival those of our National Guard. And so obviously a lot of very generous and good work going on, and I want to thank all of those individuals. Progress is being made each day, but we have a long road ahead of us. And that doesn't mean that people aren't out there suffering, because we know that they are. According to the information I just received from the Public Service Commission, there's still about 237,000 power outages in Louisiana. Now, that's down from a high of 615,000 immediately after the storm passed through. And I think it's pretty obvious the most damage to the infrastructure is in southwest Louisiana. But if you follow that track of the hurricane, you're going to find some outages in just about all the parishes that were impacted. But service is being restored fairly rapidly to North Louisiana, and we expect that will continue over the next day or two. When you get to Vernon Parish south, it becomes much harder, just the sheer amount of damage to the infrastructure. But we continue to have about 22,000 individuals who are working on power restoration. About 17,000 of those come from, I think, 29 different states. They remain in our state. They are engaged, and they are working. Obviously, until power is restored, we're going to be relying on generators to power up critical infrastructure like nursing homes and hospitals and jails and community centers and so forth. But we're also relying upon those, obviously, for powering up homes where possible. And I just want to remind people that the 15 confirmed deaths that we've had attributable to Hurricane Laura, 8 of those, so more than half, come from carbon monoxide poisoning associated with improper usage of a generator. So please be extremely cautious. Make sure you're following all of the safety guidelines that come with the generator itself. Make sure that the generator is operated outside, at least 20 feet from your house. There shouldn't be any barriers to full ventilation. You shouldn't operate it under a window or even a vent to your home. It shouldn't be in a crawl space or a garage or even a carport. And please just be very safe with this, because carbon monoxide is a colorless, odorless gas, and it overcomes individuals before they even know it. So critically important that we do that. There's been at least one family who actually placed a generator outside but underneath a vent, an attic vent, and the carbon monoxide did enter the home. Fortunately, they were not just powering up their home, they were powering up a carbon monoxide detector that alerted the family, and they were able to get out and get to safety and reposition that generator. But they were the lucky ones, obviously, and smart, because they had that detector. But if you're operating a generator and you feel dizzy or faint, leave immediately. And go outside, get fresh air, and take a look at your generator and make sure that it's positioned properly. You can get more details on how to safely use generators at getagameplan.org. I'll update on the National Guard. They have more than 6,100 soldiers and airmen activated in support of Hurricane Laura. They're obviously working on COVID testing as well, and still serving our food banks. So the National Guard has tremendous assignments that they're handling all over the state of Louisiana. The vast majority are related to Hurricane Laura. Thus far, they've distributed right at 2.8 million liters of water, 1.9 million MREs, 273,000 bags of ice, and 94,000 tarps. Today, they're supporting 31 points of distribution and 9 hubs, so that's 40 total sites throughout 18 parishes. I'm told never before has the state of Louisiana operated 40 points of distribution, 40 different sites on one day. And so we want to thank the National Guard for that. And we know that we have other partners out there that are operating commodity sites as well, like the Red Cross. And the Red Cross will sometimes have a hot food service at their points of distribution. So that we want to thank the Red Cross for the work that they're doing. The highways remain dangerous because of debris, but progress is being made, but there's also a danger because anytime you have high water events, as we've had in Cameron Parish and in certain other places around southwest Louisiana, bridges have to be inspected, and those inspections continue. Damage assessment teams are in parishes where we can assess damage in Acadiana, southwest Louisiana, and central Louisiana today. They're out replacing signs that blew down. And also installing generator power at several key intersections to power those light signals to make sure that we have the safety that we need for our motoring public. Debris removal from State Highways continues. And I want to remind people that when it comes to road conditions and closures and debris removal, you can go to 511LA.org and you can see what it looks like in real time. And you can see what's scheduled in your area in terms of debris removal. I was asked to pass along that before we make a second pass on any stretch of highway, we're going to make a first pass over all of the highways that we're responsible for, and then we'll come back for that second pass. But that's going to be listed on 511LA.org. There remain 24 weather-related closures on state routes, and so we do encourage people to make sure they're checking 511LA.org for road closures so that you don't leave and not be able to get to your destination. I also want to thank all of the partners who are providing support at our shelters. You know, it's the Department of Children and Family Services working really hard with the Red Cross, but also with the City of New Orleans, the New Orleans Health Department, just tremendous partnerships making this happen. We have a resource center at the Convention Center in New Orleans, where evacuees can assess critical services like prescription refills, infant service assistance, healthcare provider visits, COVID testing is available. They also have behavioral health counseling available. That resource center will be open today from 10 to 2 in Hall B of the Morial Convention Center. Please use the Julia Street exit, the Julia Street entrance. This is available for evacuees, and there will be shuttles from the various hotels to the convention center approximately every 20 minutes. So evacuees in New Orleans, you need to ask your DCFS manager if you've got any questions about how you access that bus stop in order to get to the resource center. You can text WELCOME NOLA to 888-777. Welcome NOLA to 888-777 to receive text alerts about these local resources. They'll also be listed at ready.nola.gov/welcome. And as always, you can go to hurricanelaura.la.gov. Speaking of shelters today, and the numbers slowed down a little bit, we continue to get people who are coming in every day, either by bus because we're transporting them or by private vehicle, to the mega shelter in Alexandria so they can be registered. And then as quickly as possible, we're moving them into a hotel because in this COVID-19 environment, we are not wanting to use congregant sheltering any more or any longer than is absolutely necessary. But last night, there were 11,452 individuals being sheltered in the state of Louisiana. 10,980 were in the non-congregant shelters that we're talking about. So we're using hotels in New Orleans, Baton Rouge, Shreveport, 46 hotels altogether. The vast majority are in New Orleans. There were only 472 in congregant shelters, and many of those people have already been moved out today to a hotel room. But if you need shelter, text LA Shelter to 898-211 for information about where to go. Also want to provide a little information about the Blue Roof program. So this is a mission assignment that moved from FEMA to the Corps of Engineers. And it is the first step in our sheltering plan because we really would like for people to stay in their home. And sometimes it's just the roof damage that prevents the home from being safe, habitable, and secure. And so there's this mission assignment has been assigned to the Corps of Engineers. The program has been activated, and work will start in the next couple of days. But in the meantime, people in the following parishes can register for the Blue Roof program. And we encourage them to do this if they have roof damage. That's Cameron Parish, Calcasieu Parish, Beauregard, Allen, Jeff Davis, and Vernon. This is a no-cost temporary service to give homeowners roof protection until a permanent repair can be completed. And residents can register by calling 888-766-3258. 888-766-3258. With respect to COVID testing, one of the functions that's being performed by the National Guard is the COVID testing across the state of Louisiana. And they're coordinating that with the Department of Health. There are community test sites available in Jefferson, New Orleans, and Baton Rouge areas. We also have a test site operating in Calcasieu Parish at McNeese State University and other sites as well. And we certainly have more that are planned. I know that this is a stressful time and that we're focused on responding to the hurricane, recovering from the hurricane, but we still have this public health emergency, and I'm asking everyone to pay particular attention to it. So as you're out and about being a good neighbor to people who need help right now, and which I thank you for, please go the extra step to be a really, really good neighbor, and that is wear your mask, stay 6 feet distant from people not from your immediate household. Wash your hands frequently. If you're symptomatic, stay home. And all of that is incredibly important. I do want to remind people that Labor Day is this weekend. And I know that there are typical Labor Day activities, a lot of barbecues, a lot of social functions. I want to remind folks that it was Memorial Day here in Louisiana and across the Sun Belt that really kickstarted the last surge. That caused us to pause in phase two, really try to get back in control of the virus to the degree that we could to flatten the curve again. We have been largely successful with staying in phase two, the additional mitigation measures with closing bars for home for on-premises consumption, the mask mandate, restricting the social gathering size. But it's these small, informal functions that to a very large degree drive transmission of COVID. And so we're asking individuals to be cognizant of that. Don't engage in activities that will do this. And then we're going to be much more successful in being able to move forward with as many of our businesses open to the maximum degree possible. As you know, we've already opened our schools. The vast majority are already open. The remainder are going to come online just on the other side of Labor Day. And all of this is happening when we've lost about a week of much of our testing. So I am imploring all the people of Louisiana to do what you can to make Labor Day safe, COVID safe. Incredibly important if we're going to be able to move forward with more openings and less restrictions. I will be headed to Lake Charles today, very shortly, after the conclusion of this press conference, to meet with local officials. I'll visit one of the points of distribution sites. We will tour some of the damage, and I expect to have a press availability with local press there on Saturday as well. I was last there on Saturday when President Trump visited. And I look forward to going back and talking to individuals face-to-face. Obviously, I talk to them every day by telephone, but there's just no substitute for a personal visit. Tomorrow, I'll be in at least meeting with individuals from four other parishes, with at least two stops. So we're gonna meet with officials from Beauregard Parish and Vernon, and also Allen and Jefferson Davis. And then we will be scheduling trips north as soon as we can get there, especially focusing on Wynn and Jackson parishes. Okay, so with that, we've got a lot going on. I'll take a few questions, but it may be a short question and answers today because I do have a flight scheduled to take me to Lake Charles. Sam, I knew you'd be first. Yeah, well, the non-congregant sheltering plan was pre-approved when we asked for the emergency declaration. I declared an emergency, then we asked the federal government for a pre-landfall declaration. That declaration included non-congregant sheltering. And so this is something that FEMA will be paying. Currently, the cost share is 75% federal, 25% state. Given the magnitude of the damage and how widespread it is across the state of Louisiana, how long this recovery is going to last, and just how many different services we're going to have to provide, at this point, I anticipate that we're going to go well beyond the threshold that would qualify us for a 90-10 cost share. So we will be bearing ultimately 10% of the cost of the sheltering operations that we're doing right now. I cannot tell you how much of the cost that we've incurred thus far is related to sheltering. I will tell you, I got a report from the Division of Administration that state expenses thus far are $63 million. I think it was 63. I'll get you a better answer if that's not correct. I'm sorry, 43 million dollars. But that's going to increase tremendously. And quite frankly, I'm not sure whether any of that it relates to sheltering. I'm not sure that when the invoices are going to come to us. It's right at $700 million for the state. And by the way, we're at that amount for COVID, and because COVID is working through FEMA under the Stafford Act as well, and so we all of our COVID expenses were 75-25. We've gone beyond that threshold. We've requested approval to go to 90-10 on the public health emergency. We anticipate we're going to be successful, and hopefully we'll have some news on that in the near future. Yes, sir. Yeah. Yeah. Well, and it wasn't just in the state, right? It was across the country. It came out last night. I haven't been able to review it in any detail, but this is what I believe we know about this particular order. It's going to be effective September the 1st. Yesterday through the end of the year, December the 31st of 2020. It applies to tenants or lessees or residents of residential property that complete a declaration saying that they have used best efforts to obtain government rental assistance, that they earn no more than $99,000 they earned in 2020, that they're unable to pay their full rent due to loss of income, or reduction in work hours, that they have used best efforts to make partial payments, and that absent some relief on the evictions, that they would likely face homelessness or need a congregant shelter. So that's what I know about it. Obviously, for any individuals who are facing eviction, that's going to be welcome news. But they do need to know that there's nothing in the order that gets rid of the obligation to pay rent at some point. And late fees can continue to accrue as well. And it doesn't halt evictions for reasons other than inability to pay rent. So you have a lot of obligations in a rental agreement that you're responsible for, you know, whether it's your conduct and damage to the property or whatever. So the only obligation that may be held in abeyance pursuant to the CDC order that came out would be the failure to pay rent. It's critically important that tenants communicate with their landlords to make sure that communication happens and that the landlord's aware of the moratorium. And then obviously we're going to continue to advocate for federal rental assistance so that we can get those landlords paid as well. But this happened last night, and we're trying to figure out exactly how it is going to work. We don't know yet, but that's what we know about the program. Yes, sir.
You mentioned how a lot of Southwest Louisiana is essentially uninhabitable right now. Yeah. Talk about how long that's going to be the case. I know as of yesterday,
Well, this is going to be an unsatisfactory answer. It is impossible to know with any precision. We're going to shelter people as long as we need to. And at the end of 30 days, we may transition into TSA, which hopefully will be seamless for the evacuees. But we will continue to rely on hotels for non-congregant sheltering. But we will move from the contracts that are being entered into between the state, GOSEP, and these hotels, and hopefully transition to TSA, which is a voucher program. But we would really like to continue to partner with the same hotels, because we have all of the incident command teams and the resource centers located, and we've got the food service organized and going to these hotels. And so we really want to continue to use that for as long as necessary. We do hope, obviously, and expect that over time, more individuals will be able to return home. Again, they need to follow the guidance of their locals about when they're able to reenter. But it's just, practically speaking, not going to be possible until basic services are restored. We know that the power outages are the most significant barrier to people going back home. And again, as you move further south along the track of the hurricane, the more damage there is to the infrastructure. We know there are more than 500 of the large transmission towers that were damaged or destroyed that have to be replaced. More than 100 of those are the very, very large towers. It takes 4 18-wheelers to bring in the components for one of those. And so we're looking at some extended period of time, perhaps as many as 4 weeks, to get power back into, Cameron and Calcasieu Parish, for example. We also have the water systems that have been damaged. And it's not just the power outage, it's the actual damage that has to be repaired. And we are working with the water systems to be able to allow for full assessments of those systems and then the needed repairs as soon as possible. And some of those repairs at the outset will be temporary just to get the system up and running. And then over time, as they are able, they'll affect the more permanent repairs. But right now, Sam, we just don't know. And I can tell you that we're going to move it just as fast as we possibly can. It's a relief for us to know that we have those 17,000 line workers here in Louisiana restoring power, in addition to the 6,000 or so that are always in Louisiana. We know that we are sourcing the towers that we need from other states. I think we sourced 30. When I say we, this is the Public Service Commission function. So, and they're doing great work, but they were able to source, I think, 30 of these towers in Florida that are coming in. And of course, we have to have a lot more than that. Any other quick questions before I take off? Look, I want to thank you all again for continuing to cover this. It is incredibly important that individuals get accurate information and important information like phone numbers and email addresses, website addresses, I should say, for accessing services and your help in spreading that message is important. It's also important that people have better sources of information than what's floating around on the internet. And social media is a blessing, but it is also a curse. And much of what we're doing is dispelling just absolute false information that just seems to just, for whatever reason, it spreads faster than the accurate information out there. And so the degree to which you all help with that, I just want you to know, is very important for the people of Louisiana, so that they know what's going on and they can access the assistance that's being made available to them in record amounts and in record time. And that's what our goal is to continue that. But we are very mindful that people's lives are turned upside down. Tens of thousands of our citizens are not at home. They're not at work. They're scattered here, there, and yonder. We think we may have 10,000 people in Texas at their non-congregant shelters. And we're working with the Texas authorities to get a better, we know it's at least 3,000, but they only registered head of households. So now we're trying to figure out how many other Louisianans are with those heads of households. And so this is going to be a long recovery, and we're going to make progress every single day. We're going to move as fast as we can possibly move, working with all our state and local partners. But we are mindful that, people are hurting. And so we ask that people do what they can, be generous in their donations, donate your time as well as your money if you're able. And being a good neighbor means being conscious of, COVID. And as always, let's lift one another up in prayer and our state as, well. And we're going to get through this. And on the other side of it, we're going to be better and stronger than we've ever been. And we're going to have more mitigation in place so that the next time we have a storm, there will be less damage to these same facilities and so forth. But we're a long time from that, and I'm aware of it. But we're going to work as hard as we can every single day. So thank all of you. We will see you next. Christina, when will that be? Tomorrow at 10:30. Thank you very much. And thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you, sir.